Let me talk to you about our situation. In the beginning, you remember the story of Adam and Eve. And you remember that Adam and Eve were both naked and they were unashamed as God had created them. There was a bond of trust and love between them. And Satan came into the picture and tempted them not to trust God. They were to think of things in their own terms. He introduced to them a lie that maybe God was holding out on them, that the tree that he told them not to eat actually was good for the knowledge of good and evil, but it would make them like God. And that seemed very attractive to them. And so, in the hopes that they might become like God, in spite of what God was doing in them, they took of the fruit and ate it, and they began to see what is good and what is evil. I've been talking to you about the story about Peace Child and about the Sawi Indians. And I talked to you about the fact that they were headhunters and they were cannibals. It's interesting to note that then they ate the flesh of human beings. They would tell others who had not yet eaten that when they ate the flesh of human beings, their eyes were opened to know the difference between good and evil. Where did that come from? Where did that come from? So in the beginnings, Satan sowed seeds of distrust and division and selfishness and hatred and anger and war and abuse, all kinds of pollution. God was all about bringing about unity once again. But in the process, there needed to be another division. And that was a division between those that he was going to use to reveal himself and those who had chosen to go away on their own down a path that led to the kinds of things that we see around us in the world today. When we see so much hatred and anger and abuse and wars and lust and passion, it was a result of Adam's choice. He wanted to become like God. He wanted to be God himself. And in so doing, he became like the devil. And so we see the fruits of that all around us. God let men go according to their desires, and the world became what we see today. In the middle of that, he formed another nation. That nation was the nation of Israel, the Jewish people. He was going to use that nation to reveal himself to the rest of the world. He started with Abraham, chose him, brought him to himself, called him into a land that he was going to give him, and then he prospered him. He also trained him in the process, training him to learn to trust God. That's really where it's all about, and that's where it all began in the difficulties that we've gotten ourselves into. We decided not to trust God, and now God is bringing us around full cycle to the place where we should have been at the beginning. He's teaching us then to trust him. Well, there is this division then. There are those who are of the world in terms of going the way that Adam chose for them. And then there are those that God has singled out and made into a nation called the Jewish nation. God was revealing himself to them, giving them his laws, explaining his character, explaining also what behaviors that he expected of them. And in the process, he also gave them laws concerning the sacrificial system that would be a system that would demonstrate to these people that there was a way in which they could be forgiven of their sins. That way was through the shedding of blood. That way was pointing forward to the day in which Jesus would come and Jesus would die in the place of sinners. So we would have the Gentile nations, all those that had gone their own way. And then there was this nation called Israel, the Jewish people and the Gentiles. Over the years, you read about it through the Old Testament. God worked specifically not exclusively, but mostly with the children of Israel. He was giving them blessings, he was protecting them, providing for them, and disciplining them, training them to behave the way they should, but they would not. They were rebellious, turned away from God. He had to send them off into captivity amongst the other nations, and then he brought them back, and they repented, but they continued in their sinful ways. All of this to demonstrate that though he had worked with them, though he had revealed himself to them, they were not able to live for him. They were not able to live up to the standard of the Ten Commandments, live up to the standards of God's holiness. As the nations watched the children of Israel, they were to see this God. They were to understand somehow through the teachings of the laws that this God was different from all the others that they had worshipped, that he probably was the only God. That was the intended purpose, that the Israelites would demonstrate this, but they did not do this well. So there was a separation. And that separation was demonstrated or exemplified. It was put in the face of the people who were Gentiles by the fact that they had no approach to God whatsoever. The Israelites had a temple. They first had a tabernacle. That was what Moses built or had made in the wilderness. Then there was this temple that was built by Solomon. And then later there was a large, incredibly large temple that was built by Herod. And the temple was designed to show that there was a difference between the people that God was dealing with and the people who had rejected him altogether. That difference was emphasized starkly by a wall in the middle of the courts that surrounded the holy place. If I had that thing working, I'd have a picture up here and I could show it to you. But since I don't, let me just talk to you a little bit about it. In the center of the whole complex that was surrounded by walls, there is the holy place. There is a building there, and there is the holy place, and then the Holy of Holies. The Holy of Holies was the place that represented the presence of God. The holy place was the place of activity of the priests as they brought incense before God and as they sacrificed just outside of that. And there was a place that was just simply accessible by the priests. Outside of that was a place that was accessible only by the Israelites, the male Israelites. And then there was a large area toward the front of this building that was the court of the women Israelites, and they could be there and they could worship God there. Then, surrounding that, all the way around the totality of this, of the building and the courts, there was a step down, several steps down, three steps down, I believe. And then there was a space, and in that space was a wall, a five-foot-high wall that surrounded, again, on all sides, this place of worship for the Jewish people. Then there was 14 steps further down, and then was that was where the area where it was called the court of the Gentiles. It was really starkly demonstrated that the Gentiles could not access the places of worship that the Jews could. There was this wall, and every place where the wall had an opening, there was a plaque that said that if you went through this gate and you were a Gentile, you did so at the risk of your life. It wasn't like trespassers will be prosecuted. It was trespassers will be killed. Such a strong message that the Gentiles were separate from the people of God. That's why when we read in the book of Ephesians chapter 2, it is so stunning to the people that is called a mystery that the Gentiles are to be included as the people of God. I invite you to take your Bibles and turn in them to the book of Ephesians, starting with chapter 2, verse 11. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that and then move on to chapter 3. He says, "Remember formerly that you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised. Now, you know that circumcision was the sign that set apart a Jewish man from a Gentile. Jewish people were circumcised. The others were not. Not all of them were not, but this was the sign that belonged to the Jews. And so they would, instead of saying the word Gentile, they would simply say the uncircumcised. It meant the same thing. So, therefore, you remember, you were Gentiles by birth and so-called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ. Everything that God was doing in moving his people towards redemption, they did not have those promises. They did not have those laws to help them to understand that they were wicked, sinful people. And they were not looking for hope in something coming. Only the Jews were excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promises that were given to Abraham, to David, and others. Without hope and without God in the world, you were hopeless. Now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away, that is, separated from the nation of Israel, have been brought near. How? Through the blood of Jesus. Through the blood of Jesus. The way to God has been opened for you. For he himself, that is Jesus, is our peace, who has made the two, that is the Gentiles and the Jews, made the two of them into one, and has destroyed the barrier. That 5-foot wall, well, is removed. It wasn't physically removed, but it no longer applied because the Jews and Gentiles could come to God equally. He says, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. He's not speaking here about the Ten Commandments, but speaking about the ceremonial law. The law that was fulfilled by Jesus. Remember the law that required sacrifices for the redemption of the people, for the forgiveness of their sins. Jesus came and was that Lamb of God that fulfilled all of those pictures that were pointing forward to him. And as he fulfilled that, it was no longer needed. He took it out of the way as he fulfilled it completely. No need anymore for images of who was coming because he came and he did it. And now the way was open to God. His purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace, and in this one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross. The Jews now could come to God. You remember that there's another area of separation, both for the Jews and for the Gentiles. If you know anything about that curtain in between the holy place and the holy of holies, you'll remember that when Jesus died on the cross, God tore that curtain in half from top to bottom, a 5 to 6 inch thick curtain that was impossible to tear. He tore and said, the way now is open to me. So in his body, he reconciled both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He has now ended the enmity between the Jews and the Gentiles. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who are near. The gospel first went to the Jews, then it went to the Gentiles. And so in the same way he preached the same gospels to the Jews as he did to the Gentiles, they all came in through the same door. They became equal with one another. And therefore, they joined together in one body called the church, a body of believers that were related to one another in love because of the redemption of Christ. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. Through him we have access by one Spirit. Consequently, you're no longer foreigners or aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets who gave the teachings who helped people to understand what God was doing. with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too were built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. He calls it a dwelling because he talks about it so that people will understand that every single element of that building, all the building stones, are intertwined with each other, are interlocked with each other. They work together. Jews and Gentiles born again in believing in Christ and being put together to build a place of worship of God. That was his purpose and his plan. Now we get to the chapter in which we're on. And for this reason, Paul says, and he's going to, this is, then we're seeing a whole parenthetical statement going on from verse 2 all the way down through verse 13. Notice at verse 14 it says, "For this reason I kneel before the Father." Back up to verse 1 it says, "For this reason I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ," or Christ Jesus, "for the sake of you Gentiles." That's what that dash means. As he was saying this, all of a sudden he thought of something that he wanted to put in there, something that occurred to him that he needed to say in order for them to understand what he was getting at and why he was doing what he's doing. So that's why we have "for this reason," and then later, "for this reason." He then, in verse 13, is picking up what he had left off. So here we have a whole parenthetical statement which is filling in so that people will respond to what he's saying appropriately. So he says, "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles." Now, when he said that, well, it needed some sort of an explanation, because he's worried about something. And you'll see what he's worried about if you look down in verse 13, he says, "I ask you, therefore, do not be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are your glory." See, when he said, "I'm a prisoner," he automatically remembered that they might feel badly about the fact that he was a prisoner. And so he wants them to see that his being a prisoner actually was an incredible privilege, something that he gloried in on their behalf. So he had to go back and explain that. And that's what he's doing here. He says, back in verse 1, "For this reason I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles." How did this happen? Why is he in prison? The other night we had a couple of people come into the church service. One was Pastor Franklin Gilliam. And along with him, there was this really big guy. And they both sat down in the front. And my mother said to Mita, "Who are they?" And there was a little bit of nervousness. The fellow who was with Pastor Gilliam was indeed a prisoner. He was out of prison. He was an ex-convict that had come with his pastor. So there was, you know, well, you need to explain that, okay? So can you help us out? Are you a Christian now, right? Yes? And all of that. Well, when Paul says about himself being a prisoner of Jesus Christ, people need to understand. They know the story. They know that he had gone down at the end of his third missionary journey. He was heading on the way down to Jerusalem, and he passed through Ephesus that this letter was written to. And he told them that he was going to go to Ephesus. He had taken a vow, and he was going to the temple, and he was going to complete that vow by cutting his hair off, cutting his hair off, and performing the rituals that were required for that kind of a vow. So they knew that he was going, and they had heard that as he was going down, in every place that he stopped, there were warnings that he was going to have trouble in Jerusalem. And that, in fact, he did have trouble in Jerusalem. Because when he arrived, do you remember that when he was going down to Jerusalem, he was carrying with him a whole lot of money? Do you remember that he was asking the churches in the area of Greece and Mesopotamia? He was asking them to take collections up so that they could help out the Jewish Christians. So because there was a time of famine. And so he was making a big offering, and his desire was that the Jewish Christians who were not trusting that Gentiles could come to Christ just like they could, their idea was that they had to become Jews first, and then they could become Christians. Paul had been preaching just the opposite, because he said that, and the church in Jerusalem had agreed, but there were still a lot of other Jewish Christians that were not yet convinced of that, and they were angry at Paul, and there was division. Remember that division that started back in the Garden of Eden? That was still continuing. That's always Satan's agenda. He's looking for ways to drive wedges between people. Paul had hoped that he could bring this offering down from the Gentile churches, give it to the Jewish church, and the Jewish church would realize these people really love them. And that would be something that would contribute to the unity between Jews and Gentiles. You see, that oneness that Jesus had provided through his death didn't happen automatically. And just because they became believers, they still had to learn and understand all the implications of it. And that's why he's teaching it here. So when he gets down to Jerusalem, the Jewish Christian Peter says, Paul, really glad to see you, and really so excited about the things that are happening as a result of your ministry among the Gentiles. And I want you to see also that there's lots of Christians here now amongst the Jews, and they are all very zealous for the law. And they don't trust you. In fact, they're really not sure about you at all. Because there's this rumor going around that you say that the law is worthless, that we're not to be following it any longer, and that the temple is no longer needed, and all of these things. And we want you to dispel that for them. Help them to know that you're still a man of the law, and that you are not teaching things against our culture. So he listens to them, and they say, listen, this is what we want you to do. We have four men here who also have vows, and they need to complete their vows too, but they're poor and they don't have enough money. So we're suggesting that you pay for those sacrifices that are required, and you go with them, and people will see that, and they'll say, yeah, you know what? What we've heard about him saying the law is useless and all of that is really not true, because he is actually doing what the law requires. So this will solve our situation and will heal the rift between these particular Jews and the Gentiles. Can you do that for us, Paul? Can you do that for us? And Paul agreed to do that. I don't think that he should have. I mean, that was the right thing for him to do. But in any case, that's not my point. My point is that he did. And that when he went in on the last day to sacrifice, God stopped that completely by causing a huge uproar. Some Jews who hated him saw him in the temple. They assumed that the man Trophimus, who was a Greek who had come with Paul from the others, you know, helping bring the money and security and all that, had actually come into the temple with him. Now, into the temple meant that they had gone beyond that wall, and they had gone into the court of the Gentiles. And you remember what we said about what happened to somebody who goes through those gates, right? You go on pain of death. And so they grabbed Paul, and they dragged him out of the temple, slammed the doors, and they were beating on him. They were going to kill him. But they were stopped from doing that when the Roman soldiers, who had a fortress in the back of, just over the wall of the temple, they couldn't come into the temple, but they would be higher than the wall, and they could see what was going on in the temple courts. They saw what was going on. They came rushing down and rescued Paul, such as he was. And that began this whole long trip for Paul that lasted over 2 years, where he was arrested and he was held in prison And he stood before this tribune and the Sanhedrin, and the Sanhedrin began to berate him, and, you know, and they, Paul kind of made a mess of the whole thing by saying to them, I'm a Pharisee, a son of a Pharisee, and I'm on trial here because of the resurrection from the dead. And the Pharisees then began fighting with the Sadducees, and there became a huge confusion. And then they had to drag him out of there. I don't know about you, I don't find that to be comfortable stuff, right? It was a trial for him. And then they said, we need to take him to the governor. And they were warned by Paul's nephew that there was a plot underway, that 40 men had said, we're not going to eat until we kill this man, so that we'll ask him to send him back to the Sanhedrin for more questioning, and then we're going to kill him. But since the boy gave the warning, they sent him along with 450 soldiers up to Caesarea. And there he stood before the governor, Festus, Felix, and then Festus, and then with King Agrippa. And that was a whole 2 years in prison, waiting to be released on charges that he had were false. But at the end of that, they said, well, why don't you go back to Jerusalem and stand before... He said, listen, I have not done anything wrong. I have not sinned about... I'm willing to die if I have, but I tell you what, I am not going back there. I appeal to Caesar, which he had a right to do because he was a Roman citizen. And so they had to take him on a long trip all the way to Italy. And on that long trip by boat on the Mediterranean Sea, in the wrong time for a boat to be traveling on the sea, there arose a storm like a hurricane. And for 2 weeks, to me, that's just the worst part. I can't imagine being in a boat on the Mediterranean Sea, and then to be in the midst of a hurricane and going up and down, and you didn't know if your boat was going to fall apart. They're throwing over rigging, they're throwing over supplies, they're tying ropes under the bottom of the boat to keep it from falling apart. They all are thinking that they're going to die, but God promises that they won't. And they end up landing on an island of Malta, and then from Malta he goes up to Rome. That's what where he is when he's writing this. Okay, so he's saying, I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ. You know about this. And I know that when they are reminded of the fact that he is there because he identified with the Gentiles. He cared about them. God has sent him as an emissary to these people. And then they realize, and they do realize, that the very fact that he's a prisoner is because of them. He says so here in this passage. He says, I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. I've been sent by Christ. So I become his prisoner because this was part of my calling, and I'm a prisoner now. And so this is where I am, and I'm writing to you, and I'm going to be talking to you about how I'm praying for you. But now that I thought about this, I need to tell you that this is not a terrible hardship that you should feel bad about. Notice what he says. Surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. Yeah, that's right. I'm dedicated to you. I am called to you. I love you, and I'm here for you, and I'm going to be telling people like you about the gospel. That is the mystery that was made known to me by revelation, which I have also already written about back in the previous chapter and in the chapter before that. And reading this, you'll be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made to known in other generations. Now, wait a minute. In the Old Testament, there were passages that said that God was going to bless all nations. Remember the promise to Abraham? And I will make you a blessing, he says. You will be a blessing, and all the nations in the world will be blessed through you. The Jews interpreted that to mean that people could become proselytes, that they could become Jews, and that would be a blessing for them. But nobody had any inkling whatsoever that somehow there was going to come a time when Jewishness would mean nothing and gentleness would mean nothing, but there would be this oneness in Christ. That was the mystery that they didn't understand. So, which was not made known to men in other generations, but has now been revealed by the Spirit of God through God's holy apostles and prophets. This mystery is that the gospel that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, sharers together in the promises of Christ Jesus. So he is saying there's this mystery, and I have been the emissary for this mystery. Notice how his attitude toward that is displayed here. I became a servant of this gospel. He always thought of himself as one, as a servant of God. What do you want me to do? I will do it. By the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Remember back in chapter 1, we talked about being dead. Verse chapter 2 as well, about God choosing us, calling us, redeeming us, and adopting us all by grace. And that was when we were dead in our trespasses and sins. He's saying that it was God's power and his grace raising me to life spiritually and giving me this calling that I might serve him in this way. Although I'm the least, I am less than the least of all God's people. You would think that it might be a pretty heady thing to be the one who is the apostle to the Gentiles. Paul saw it as like, I am just totally unworthy of this. He has got humility, and he is all about God's grace. This grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ and to make it plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was hidden in God, but who created all things. His intent was now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. Do you realize that there are people, there are angels that are watching you, that are watching what God is doing in the church? They were there as they saw sin enter into the world in division and hatred, fighting, jealousy, anger, lust, all entered in as death took over. And now they are very interested in watching and seeing God's wisdom as he has let the people go for ages now, following the desires of their hearts, realizing what were then the consequences of turning away from God, separating themselves from him. And then seeing also that he pulls together a people of his own, and he loves them, and he's covenantally related to them. He will not leave them or forsake them. He will discipline them, love them as a father loves a child, so that they might understand that when Christ comes, that he provides a way that he might have that relationship directly with every single person who comes to him by faith, whether they are Gentile or whether they are Jew. And the angels are watching this in rapt interest, seeing the wisdom of God, taking all of this hatred and division and bringing it together into a wholeness of people gathered together in love. It's not perfected. It's not perfected, but it will be. But it is a work that is in progress that he is doing. Paul doesn't see himself as any great shakes. He has come in as everybody else has. He sees himself rather as the least, less than the least of all the others, because he persecuted the church of Christ. He was a terrorist to the church of Christ, trying to grab people and put them in prison and see them killed. But he says, all of this has been reversed, and God has given me the opportunity to be a minister to those who had no hope, who were totally separate from any possibility of being redeemed. And they've been given this relationship with God. They walk into his presence as his children, and he loves them and listens to them. In him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. So I ask you then not to be discouraged. I'm in prison. Yeah, I'm in prison because of my sufferings for you. But you know what? That's to your glory, not to your shame. It is to your glory, because my being in prison is telling the world that God thinks that you are worth it. that he is loving you and raising you to the place of being his children. And he is permitting me to be involved in that suffering of Christ to see that it happens. So where are we in all of this? What is our attitude toward the Gentiles? I have a feeling that many of us probably would identify more with the Jews than with the Gentiles. We would say, you know what, all my life I've been coming to church, all my life I've known about God. And then there are those who are outside there, and those are the ones that have been estranged for so many years. And we had the same sort of feelings that the Jews have had. Superiority. Somehow or another that those people don't matter so much as we do. What is our attitude towards our neighbors that we live with, that we work with, to those who are in our community from any possible nationality? I told you that I was reading the book Peace Child. There's a chapter here called Baptism of Strangeness. That's often how we feel about people that are different from us. They are strange. They do things strangely. They dress strangely. They eat strangely. And so we see that as something that keeps us from being involved in their lives. But these missionaries, Don Richardson and his wife Carol, went down to Irian Jaya, which is the western half of the island of Papua New Guinea, went down there amongst the cannibals and headhunters. And these were strange people. I mean, what we have around here is not anything in comparison to what they confronted. Here's the story of them after Don Richardson had spent months building a one-room place for them to live. And they are, and the three tribes that have joined together to be with him, they really love him. They call him Tuan. A Tuan is one of the white men who come, and they're really happy that he's decided to live with them. Because, well, you know, on the base level, the Tuans bring machetes and axes, and food and all kinds of other things that the other tribes don't have. And so they get the feeling of, you know, we're special. So they were really glad that Don and Carol were moving in with them with their little boy who was like a year and a half. So the day comes in which he is bringing his wife and his son up the river in 65 miles away from civilization of any kind. And he encounters interesting things on the way. There are dugout canoes of men who are anticipating their coming. And as soon as he comes around the bend, they start sending signals up the river that they're coming. And once they arrive, they see 200 warriors. 200 warriors sitting on the edge of the river, standing on the edge of the river. And listen to this. Carol, it says here, "Look at them," Carol breathed. Closer now, we could see garish white and ochre paint smeared on their faces in such a way as to make their eye sockets, by contrast, look like gaping black holes. We could see in detail the spiny ridges of barbs tapering up to the points of their spears. We could hear the thin sizzle of their whispering, rising in pitch as excitement welled up within them. It was hard to believe they were the same people had only days before had so meekly gathered the materials for our home. And then it had been easy to forget that behind their friendly mannerisms and disarming enthusiasm, they were still headhunters and cannibals. And now they really looked the part. A little background here. You remember the story, the fact that this particular tribe really valued treachery? Really valued luring people in with friendliness and then killing them and eating them. Okay, so this is in the background of people's thinking as they are now approaching this army of 200. Okay, think about that as he speaks. He says, "Had I misread their intentions? Was this their way of expressing welcome, or was it something else? Had I missed God's leading in bringing Carol and Stephen here so soon? I could hear my heart pounding as if in an echo chamber. Some of the Sahwi stepped into the water and gripped the sides of our dugout. Lord God, have I been a fool? These men have never even learned to respect a policeman, let alone honor you. And here we are, man and wife and child, 65 river miles from the nearest government post, defenseless except for your spirits surrounding us. It is only human presumption. Instead of your peace that has been sustaining us, as the Sahwi drew our dugout higher onto the mud bank, the answer came from within my own heart. That peace, as if it is only human presumption, still had one essential thing in its favor. In the moment of crisis, it was still there. Surely, I thought, if it wasn't from God, it would have deserted me by now. Unimpressed by the alarm of my senses and amused by the warnings of mere reason, that peace kept reinforcing my inmost core. But what about Carol and Stephen? Kneeling, I reached under the canopy and lifted Stephen from Carol's lap. From my arms, he beamed a cherubic smile at the war-painted host. Reaching toward them with his own chubby arms, Carol slipped out from under the canopy and stood beside me. She was awed, excited, but revealed no trace of anxiety. Warily, the kayaker paddlers in the front part of the dugout stepped ashore, clearing our way. We proceeded to the tip of the canoe, stepped off into the midst of the crowd, and then the other three paddlers followed, shouldering our equipment. Some seized my right arm. It was Hadi. He was the friend. He is intoxicated with excitement. Another hand gripped my shoulder. Hato. Yes, another friend. His one eye gleamed with the light of its own. Older Sahwi women were fondling Carol and Stephen incredulously. Men were crowding closer as dusk fell. I handed Stephen to Carol that my arms might be free to clear a way through the crowd toward our home, still 50 yards distant, and the warriors, however, were now so packed, so tightly around us, it was impossible to move. We could do nothing but submit to their will and stand waiting, and suddenly, the suppressed whispering around us began to swell into a cry of, "Issa! Issa! Issa!" from somewhere behind me. A loud voice shrieked, a high-pitched command, a signal for what? I don't know. Carol's gaze met mine. While Stephen quickly searched both her eyes, her clear blue eyes were still radiant, trustful, without the slightest suggestion of, "Why have you brought me here?" Seeing her look, Stephen relaxed again on her shoulder, and I knew, as before, I had chosen the right woman. The test was not over yet, however. Triggered by the loud signal, a heavy fusillade of drum beating exploded around us, making us shudder involuntarily. Peering through the crowd, I saw one of the drums, thin-waisted, flared at both ends, with its body and its full-length handle were engraved with exotic ancestral designs. The drumhead itself was a speckled black lizard glued on with human blood, dark rivulets of which had been allowed to trickle down as part of the decoration. The otherness of the Sahwi. Gradually, the drummers synchronized their rhythms into a steady, booming thunder, whereupon the entire host erupted in a paroxysm of wild shouting, leaping in the air, jabbing their spears up and down. Standing at the heart of the tumult, we studied the wildly animated faces of the celebrants, awed by the fierce intensity of their emotion, their absolute involvement in the meaning of the moment. And presently the shouting became chanting and leaping, gave way to dancing, and wave after wave of warriors swirled closer as if to engulf us. It's like a baptism, I thought, a baptism of primitive spirit, of strangeness. And then suddenly, in the blue glow of twilight, a presence stronger than the presence of the multitude enveloped us. The same presence that had first drawn us to trust in Christ and then wooed us across continents and oceans to this very jungle clearing. Before that presence, every superficial thought and feeling fled away, and I felt a deep probe go through my motives. Missionary, he was asking, why are you here? It was a question that I had often fielded from the lips of unbelievers. Now my Lord was asking it, and there was no escape from the question. The eyes of every Sawi dancer seemed to be asking it. Their voices seemed to chant it. Their drums echoed it. I reviewed answers that I had used in the past, discarding them one by one. Secondary incidental reasons no longer mattered, nor could ulterior ambitions endure the four-dimensional reality of our task, which is now had assumed. The descent to new bedrock took a few moments. Then I breathed my answer. Lord Jesus, it is for you we stand here, immersed not in water, but in Sawi humanity. This is our baptism into the work you anticipated for us before creation. Keep us faithful. Empower us with your Spirit. May your will be done among these people as it is in heaven. And if any good comes from them, to them, through us, the honor is yours. And he replied, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall garrison your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. It was all right now. Our relationship was renewed. I could feel a fresh spring welling up inside. How would you answer his question? What are you doing here? What are you doing here? Why are you living where you live? Why are you working where you work? How do you see those around you? Do you see yourself baptized into a group of people who need you desperately? Would you say with Don Richardson that, Lord Jesus, I am here for you, and I'm here to glorify you, and if there is some way in which I might be a blessing to the people that I'm immersed in, then let it be. Let it be. If that is your feeling, that is your desire, is that your perspective, then you will also hear the words that I will be with you and I will give you peace. So often we deny ourselves access to the people that are around us because we're afraid. They're afraid that somehow God will let go of us. Joel sang a song for us that he will hold me fast. And he will. And he will, but you make the step forward. Do what you can do. Say what you can say. Let God lead you. This is your baptism into the strangeness of our society. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word and for the things you teach us. Thank you that we're not just talking about Gentiles and Jews, but we're talking about all men of all places, from all nations, coming together in the Church of Jesus Christ. This is the grand design. This is what you're doing, and we're part of it. Help us, Lord, not to think of ourselves as those who are searching for the American dream, but as those who are searching to be used in this ultimate purpose that the angels are watching. May they not be disappointed in what they see. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.